Thank you for the introduction. So the real life motivation for this talk is side channel attacks. So as you know, even perfectly secure system in black box can become completely insecure when subject to side channel attacks, and there exist a bunch of different side channel attacks. So for example, there are power analysis attacks, electromagnetic attacks, timing attacks, and even recently, people have started to study in the academic world acoustic attacks. So what cryptographers try to do is to find nice way to formalize the reality and then to prove stuff in it. But what is difficult with side channel attacks is that there are so many possible ways of leaking information in the real world that it's a bit tricky to formalize. So this is an example of a leakage trace obtained by electromagnetic attack where many traces have been combined together. And so we are going to see how we can try to model the leakage that this trace is giving us. And it turns out that there are a lot of different models. So you can have abstract models, you can have concrete models, idealized models, and so on. Okay, so let's start by an extremely concrete model which is trying to replicate reality as nicely as possible. And so this would be concrete modelizations of leakage. And in this kind of modelization, so a very popular one which I will focus on, but you can take any other one if you want. A popular one is the Hamming weight plus Gaussian. So we will consider that each node of interest, so each red value here, follows a distribution x, and its leakage is a randomized function y equal f of x, and so the leakage is the blue curve, and x is the red points. So what we have as a popular one is f of x equal Hamming weight of x plus some Gaussian noise. And this is quite realistic, and we can see, for example, here that if you trace a line at the level of zero and you measure the average distance to the line, then it will follow a Gaussian, and then you can see that this model makes sense, and similarly for the line, the horizontal line at one. But the issue with that is that it's very nice for modeling reality, but if you want to do mathematical proofs in it, then it becomes a bit complicated. So cryptographers have come up with more abstract models, which still retain some relevance in terms of realism, because as they are abstract, they can encompass many different attacks. And these are noisy leakage models. And in this model, we will consider that the leakage y bias the expected distribution of x. So this is quite a generic statement. And so in practice, what you can do is you will choose a certain bias metric. So for example, Proof and Riva, they took a bias metric which is the expected value of the distance between x and x given y. Then Diabolski, Duke, and Faust took another metric, which is based on the statistical distance, and you can take actually any distance you want, but these two were the most popular. So this is still quite realistic, but it's also very hard to work with. So especially if you look at the proof of the Proof Rivin paper, they are extremely long. And something else which is more fundamentally tricky is that in this definition, the definition implicitly depends of x. So if you are doing a proof, then you have to always keep in mind what is x, and this complicates like composition theorems. How do you do in this kind of cases? And finally, we have much more idealized models, which are probing models and which are arguably the most popular in cryptography. So for example, we have the threshold probing model by Ishai, Sai, and Wagner. And in this model, you will consider that the adversary can choose exactly T nodes to probe, and he will know exactly the value of this node, and the other ones, he will not know it. The random probing model is also used a bit, and in this model, each probe will know the value of a node with the probability epsilon, and with the probability 1 minus epsilon, the probe will not learn anything. So as we can see, this is much more idealized, but on the other hand, it's also much easier to work with for computer scientists because it's just the information is just 0 or 1, and then it's quite simple, and that's why it has been used a lot. And finally, what people have done on a practical side is to propose secure compilers to protect circuits. So the most famous one is masking, as proposed first by Ishai, Sai, and Wagner. So what we have is that we have circuit compilers to protect circuits against side-channel attacks, and then we have a bunch of different leakage models which have different properties, and the most concrete one is the one at the top, and so we want to prove that the circuit compiler is secure for some circuit model, for some concrete leakage model modelization. And so what we are going to do is to do a chain of reductions. So let us see how it was done before. So at the bottom, you have secure compilers, then you have probing models, then you have noisy leakage models, and then we have concrete leakage, and then we have paths which go from the top to the bottom, which is what we want. But unfortunately, a major issue of this reduction is that they were often not quite efficient. So for example, if you look at the reduction between the noisy leakage, the SD noisy leakage model and the random probing model, then you lose a factor n, where n is the size of the underlying field. So for example, if you work with AES, then it will be 256. If you work with New Hope, then it will be about 12,000. So this can be quite a lot. And then if you take into account this loss to set the parameters of your system, then it gives you a proof which is completely meaningless in practice, and you cannot rely on it at all. So what we did in this work was come up with, so first, at a conceptual level, what we observed is that the SD noisy leakage model and the Euclidean norm noisy leakage model, they can be expressed in the same framework. And so this framework will be everything which is in orange. And then within this framework, we decided, okay, instead of instantiating this framework the way they did, maybe we can instantiate it in other ways. And this gave us two new leakage models. Then what we did was, so we took these new leakage models and we worked with them. And we found out that they allow us to have much better proof in terms of tightness loss. So if you want to go from the top to, say, the compiler at the bottom left, then if we use our new leakage models compared to the SD noisy leakage model, for example, then we will have a better proof by a factor big O tilde of n. And so it essentially solves one big drawback that we had by using the SD noisy leakage model. Before I continue, we also have dashed arrows. And so these are also ways where we can do reductions, but these arrows entail to use a very strong hypothesis, which is, for those who know, leak-free refresh. And so we managed to have better proofs, both if we decide not to use the leak-free refresh assumption, and both if we decide to use the leak-free refresh assumption. All right, so the roadmap will be as follows. So we will unify the noisy leakage models and we will propose new ones. Then we are going to link the noisy leakage models to the concrete modelization of leakage, so it's the top layer. And then we are going to link the noisy leakage models to probing models, so it's the layer just underneath noisy leakage models. And then we will also prove compiler directly in the noisy leakage model. All right, so the main tool which we use is the pointwise mutual information. So it's a tool which is used a lot in computational linguistics, and so the definition is essentially as follows. The PMI of X and Y for two distribution X and Y, it will be the logarithm of the following ratio. So on the numerator, you will have the joint distribution of X and Y, and on the denominator, you will have the product distribution of X and Y. And we have both the usual form, which is small PMI, and the exponential form, which is the exponential of small PMI minus one, and we will mostly use the exponential form. So it's quite useful in computational linguistics as an association measure. So if you have two words which are strongly correlated, for example, Sean and pen, if you hear Sean, then it raises the probability that you will hear pen, and so the PMI of Sean Pen is much larger than zero. If you have two words which are unrelated, like banana and bag, then the PMI will be about zero. And if you have two words which are contradictory, such as pineapple and Italian pizza, then it will be much less than zero. And a first nice observation is that actually the mutual information, which is used a lot in leakage resilient crypto, can be expressed very simply as the expected value of the PMI. All right. So now what we did was redefine the existing leakage metrics from the PMI, and we can observe that the redefinition is very simple. So for example, the statistical distance metric, it will be the expected value of the PMI. So what we decided to do is, so we saw that the statistical distance, it's an average. And so we thought, what if we make this definition stronger? So here, it's an average over X and over Y. So we decided, what if instead of taking the average, we take the maximum? So this gives the ARE leakage metric, so for average relative error, and RE for relative error. So ARE will take the maximum over X, but still keeps the average over Y, and RE will take the maximum over both. All right? So we note that ARE and RE, they are worst case metrics in some sense because you use the maximum, and the previous metrics, they were average case metrics. So this raises three questions. So the first one is, does it change their properties? Because you're taking different definitions, so do you still have the same composition theorems and self-reducibility theorems and so on? Does it imply stronger conditions? Because you're taking a stronger definition, so it might put more constraint on you in practice. And does it provide better bound? And a little spoiler, the answer to these three questions are yes, not really, and yes. Okay, so first, some nice properties that we have. So we observe that we have some equivalences with the other metrics. So for example, the ARE metric and the SD noisy metric, they are equivalent. And we also obtain some inequalities, and we manage, for example, to bound the mutual information in simpler and tighter ways than with previous proofs. And this is just due to the simple insight that all of these values can be expressed with the PMI. We also have a self-reducibility theorem, which tells us essentially that if you have a function f, a randomized leakage function, which is noisy for some distribution x, then it will be noisy with the same level of noisiness for another distribution x prime, and similarly for the ARE noisy metric. And this is quite nice for us because it allows us to say we don't care that much about the underlying distribution, and we can and we don't have any more to take into account when we do our proofs which distribution we are working on. And that makes our life easier. So DFS16 had a similar theorem for the statistical distance, but with a blow up and only for the distribution X uniform. So then for the second step, so we want to link concrete leakage to noisy leakage. And so for example, if you consider the usual case where the distribution X will follow a uniform distribution over 0 to say here 2 to the 4 minus 1. Then if we look at its Hamming weight, it will follow a binomial distribution. And then if you add some noise, you will obtain this green curve. And if you do the average of all these green curves, you will obtain the orange curve. And this is quite nice because it allows us, we can actually express the PMI, the PMI as the ratio between a green curve and the orange curve minus one. So it also helps us to understand better what's going on. And each metric can be interpreted as the average or the maximum or whatever of this very simple value. And so we show the following bounds and even this following asymptotic values for all of these four metrics. And the key takeaway is that essentially this, all these values, they scale at the same speed. So that means that we don't lose much by using our new metrics compared to the first one. So that answers the first question. The second question. So now for the last question, do these metrics allow us to have better proofs? And the answer is yes. So if we look at the reduction between the noisy leakage model and the random probing model, what do we have? So essentially, the proof is to simulate a noisy adversary with a random probing adversary. And in DDF-14, they show that to simulate a delta SD noisy adversary, then you require a random probing adversary with a parameter epsilon equal n times delta. In our case, with our new metric, we show the same. Instead of needing a random probing adversary with epsilon equal n times delta, we have only delta. So we don't have this this overhead of n in the reduction. And the critical step is that we try to express the epsilon of the random probing adversary from delta. And at some point, we get this very simple formula. And then if we rely on the statistical distance, we lose a factor n. And at a high level, the reason is because the sum is less than n times the max. I mean, you need to use this this very loose argument in your proof if you want to go through. And so this is where you take a factor n. In our case, we just say that the max is less than the max, and then we don't lose anything. We believe that a fundamental reason is that the random probing model and the ARE noisy leakage model are worst case, whereas the statistical distance noisy leakage model is average case. And we also show that an ARE noisy adversary can simulate a random probing adversary, so the reduction goes in both directions, and this allows us to say in the end that at least these four leakage models, they are all equivalent. So this means that in the graph at the very beginning, we have all this bunch of leakage models, and at least four of them, you can say, okay, they are essentially the same. If you omit the loss of reductions, the polynomial loss that you get in reductions. I would like to conclude. So what we did was the following, is that first, we proposed new noisy leakage metrics, and we unified all of them with a very simple tool, a natural tool. Then we linked them to a concrete modelization of leakage. Then we did a reduction in both directions between this layer and this layer. And finally, there is something else that we did, is that we also proved compilers directly in the ARE noisy leakage model. So unfortunately, I don't have time to present this in this presentation. But it's actually my favorite part in the paper because we use hardness amplification as in Rivin proof. But in Rivin proof, when they do hardness amplification, they have a bunch of additional looseness. They lose a lot when they do this hardness amplification. So first, we don't lose that. And in addition, something really nice is that we can use the Reni divergence, which is a tool which is used a lot in lattice-based crypto, and it allows to get much better proof. And a key point of the Reni divergence is that if you use the Reni divergence to do security proofs, instead of, suppose you are using the statistical distance, then you need to make your statistical distance scale with the security level, but here we only need to make the Rényi divergence scale with the number of leakage, and the number of leakage will usually be much less than the security level. And so in the end, it allows us to take much more aggressive parameters and still have a provable way to say that this is still secure. And this is not in the talk, but this is in our paper. And I think that this concludes my talk, so thank you for your attention.
Please come to the mics near the stage. No questions? I have a quick question, if possible.
Yeah.
So what would be the practical implications of your result? Is it like with any tighter security, you get stronger security for the same parameters, or?
Yeah, so in our paper, at some point, we got a table showing showing the implications of our paper, but at a high level, the idea is that the security of your proof will be a function of the signal-to-noise ratio and of the masking order. So if the signal-to-noise ratio becomes lower and the masking order becomes higher, then you will have more security. And if you do the proofs, then depending on the model that you have, you will have a different function. In our case, the function will the function of the security will grow much higher than with the other ones. And it says that you need a lower masking order, and you need less signal to, and you need your signal to noise ratio to be not as low as with previous models.
Thank you. Okay, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.